Sabine O'Hara, Dean of the University of the District of Columbia's College of Agriculture, Urban Sustainability and Environmental Sciences. Welcome to Causes. As a land-grant university, the University of the District of Columbia conducts research on urban agriculture and provides community education programs that build capacity and knowledge about cutting-edge ways of growing food in small urban spaces using new technology in addition to more traditional methods of urban gardening. On this edition of Causes, you will learn more about the university's Firebird Farm, formerly known as Moorkirk Farm of Causes. William Hare is Associate Dean for Land Grant Programs, and as the nation's only urban land grant institution, the university must marry the aspects of a traditional land grant institution of higher education with an urban environment. Associate Dean Hare is the person directly responsible for implementing the land grant functions of Causes. So this farm here that we run is not the usual kind of farm. We don't grow cash crops here. We don't have dairy cattle either. So tell us, what's the whole concept, the whole idea behind this farm?
Well, thank you, Dean. The University of the District of Columbia is uniquely the only totally urban land-grant university in the nation. And so we're basically focused on urban agriculture. And I'm sure you don't want cattle in the urban sector. So we're mandated federally to provide an opportunity to provide research-based community education to improve the quality of life of our district residents. And so if we're going to do that in the form of urban agriculture, there has to be a mechanism by which we can not only demonstrate concepts through research, but also provide an opportunity to train our urban population. And so this is why our farm is so uniquely different. Mm-hmm. We are an urban system. We have an urban farm. And so our focus is on then the urban food hub. Mm-hmm. How do we build a food system in the urban space that will allow us to provide nutrient-rich food to actually get a healthy city and healthy people?
What kind of other systems do we have here? When you say it's a demonstration site, it's a training site.
Well, if I told you that in a 30 by 64 feet hoop house, we could build a system growing fish and growing nutrient-rich crops and make $150,000 to $200,000 a year. A lot of people, even the traditional farmers, will say, you're crazy. That can't happen. But when you introduce technology and you can extend the season where you can utilize all of your space to grow food, it becomes unique. And so on the farm, we do have not only biointensive farming like tabletop garden or raised bed garden, but small plots with a lot of crops growing, but we grow food aquaponically. Now, aquaponics is where you have an integration of aquaculture, which is growing fish, and hydroponics, which is then growing crops in water. Now, how you utilize that to then fertigate also for your biointensive process is where we're leading the charge in the nation, because this is not a new concept. Mm-hmm. It's been done many, many years ago, but to focus on new urban systems is relatively new, and the kind of technology that's been integrated in this process is also new. So that's where, when you talked about the research component, we are looking at opportunities that can build a more efficient and a more effective system that, when we do put it in the community, we have a certain level of confidence that it will work, because, like you said, we've taken out the kinks. We've done yield study. We've tested the safety of the water, tested the safety of the crops, know the quality of the fish that we're producing. It's all of those things. And then we can test the nutrient uptake in the plant and look at the density. And so that's where research comes in, and that's where it's so important that we must maintain a farm like this, because it provides the capacity for not only our faculty to do the research, but for our students to do experiential learning through research projects or even community-based education, that mm-hmm. they can now take the information and disseminate it in the community. But if you don't have such a research farm, it becomes very difficult to actually provide what we call info docs or fact sheets mm-hmm. that people can just take a toolkit mm-hmm. and learn in simple English mm-hmm. how you get certain things done. So from a production perspective, we have biointensive field crops, we have aquaponics, and we do have systems where we only grow food hydroponically. That is just mm-hmm. growing it in water, and we supply the nutrients so that the plants can take them up, and we then test them and do comparative studies. What's the difference between crops growing hydroponically or growing in the soil or just the aquaponic system, and look at the difference and see how we can best make it more efficient and cost effective. And so this is exciting, because this is a paradigm shift of agriculture. I just came back from Wyoming, and Dean, the talk of the conference was urban agriculture. That's the big thing. It's like USDA, APLU, everyone wants to now say who's doing what in urban agriculture and who's the go-to university that can take the lead. And I think we're uniquely in a position that we've demonstrated that we are making a difference and moving in a specific direction. I don't think we could have done that if we had not started at this farm. Mm-hmm. It would have been a little more difficult to build it sporadically in the city, make mistakes, come back. But having this base farm to make all our mistakes, learn from our mistakes, and then take it in the community is extremely important. Mm-hmm.
So in addition to growing the food, there are huge opportunities in food preparation. It's not just revenue coming from growing food and selling it, or supplemental one's income by eating it oneself in your own family, but you can actually do something with it. And that's an important focus here too at this farm. So what's this all about, this concept of value-added food?
Well, Dean, you know, many people starve in the world mm-hmm. because they just don't know what's growing around them is food. Mm-hmm. When you're not accustomed to eating a specific crop, you look at it as a weed or not a food. And so it's not only about growing the crops, it's about getting people to understand how you actually prepare the food for consumption and what's the best way to prepare it so that you have it as a source of nutrition for your body. Unfortunately, this has been the what I would consider the weakest link mm-hmm. in the food system, because a lot of crops are grown, but you only eat what you learn to eat. Mm. You eat what your parents have taught you to eat. And so there's a lot of new foods that are healthy, that are easy to prepare, but people won't prepare because they just don't know. So having the system, remember this farm, most people will consider farm just as a food production setting. But having now an opportunity to teach people how to cook what or prepare what you've grown is extremely important. And so we have here not only a commercial kitchen in a container, but also a mechanism by which we can take the food from just the preparation stage to value addition. How do we store it? How do we keep it in its fresh form? over a specific time frame. And here we have the, I would consider the only solar powered walk-in refrigerator, mm-hmm. maybe in the entire country. Mm-hmm. And then we have a means of dehydrating and taking water and storing and maintaining the food. I always tease people, Dean, that, you know, a pound of tilapia costs $1.99. When you smoke the tilapia and dry it, it costs $15.99. That's value addition. And people will even pay $30 for it if you package it such that they can just readily eat it. And so it brings out innovation, it brings out creativity and technology. And this whole concept of value addition is where, from an economic perspective, you can actually differentiate whether, in fact, your system is going to be economically viable or just breaking even. Because by just packaging your food system, you can go from selling it for $1 a pound to $4 a pound. Mm-hmm. Just by putting a little bit more value addition to it. And I think this is a critical point. In fact, if you really want to look at the real difference between agriculture in the developed world versus agriculture in the developing world, it's value addition. Mm-hmm. It is. Where here you take corn and you can create 1 million products from it. And then in the developed countries, it's only for eating. They don't turn it to starch, they don't turn it to glucose and fructose and industrial base for sugar and adding value to it. This is what this farm is all about. It also brings out the creativity in the process. Now, how many jobs can we create out of that opportunity? Mm. And that's interesting because here we are training through our process food handler certificates. So we can then create caterers. Yeah. That's a small business opportunity. We can have a business incubator through our food drying and processing system that people can take. Number two, those food that's wasted, and like the apple and the banana and that you don't want, but dehydrated and then added with kale and dehydrated and you got smoothies. So it brings out innovation, and that's the opportunity we hope to provide at the farm, that our residents and students can participate and get certified to become their own small business operators. Mm-hmm.
So explain to us the term fertigation. What does it mean? And how does it tie into the whole water management concept at this farm? Because one of the things that is becoming increasingly important is not only that we learn how to grow crops, but how to do so with minimal amount of water, because we're running out of water in many different places, both in this country and internationally around the world.
It's so true. Water management is extremely important. And the whole concept of fertigation is the process of fertilizing while irrigating. Irrigating is the ability to move water and distribute it to grow crops. Normally, water is needed. Mm-hmm. It is extremely essential because that's the mechanism by which nutrients are taken up, is dissolved in the water, and the roots or the plants will take up the nutrients and grow. So the bottom line is, if we cannot manage our water system, then we depend on nature. Mm-hmm. And well, with climate change and mm-hmm. the sporadic rainfall, when we anticipate rain, it's not raining. When we don't want rain, then that's when it's raining. You have to be able to manage it. And again, we've been very creative at the farm because, you know, we were, you know, you wanted us to build a sustainable farm. Mm-hmm. You wanted something that we will use our natural resources. And yes, as much as we have a depletion of water sometime in the aquifer, you can manage the system so that you're also, while you're efficiently irrigating, because you're doing precise irrigation mm-hmm. through fertigation, that your water loss is minimized. So what we've built here at this farm is a solar-powered irrigation system where we can access water. And you know, sometimes I look at it and say, this is the microchip of sustainable development, especially, again, in rural sectors, mm-hmm. because we use our natural sun mm-hmm. to generate energy. We use the solar power to drive and bring water from our well. We then use the same solar energy to pump and distribute the water with increased pressure. Mm-hmm. And so what we have here is a system that allows us to now decentralize the process of moving water. Now, since we have water, we can do aquaponics. Mm-hmm. And then the waste from the fish, if we move that water that is nutrient rich, that's the concept of fertigation. And we can irrigate and pump the water close to 400, 500, 600 yards away from the source and actually grow crops with nutrient rich water. And this is a change in agriculture. This is a change because the process is take the water, put it in a tank, drive it on a tractor, put it in there, use some energy and irrigate. Now, we're basically using the process of solar energy to move the water mm-hmm. from the source. And again, uniquely, science, technology, engineering, and math. And you know what's interesting, Dean? Mm. When the young kids come and they see that, they go, wow, wow, isn't this interesting? But then they get interested in agriculture and they know that I can do engineering and still apply it to agriculture. Mm-hmm. I can be a computer scientist and still apply it to mm-hmm. agriculture. And not only that, but imagine, Dean, having a sensor mm-hmm. that now tells that system, this soil is too dry mm-hmm. and I want water, and wirelessly move the water to the system, to the field. That is where you come to precision use of water management. And this is why this farm, again, is so exciting. And when we bring people out there and show them what we're doing, they're totally amazed that UDC, as a small university, can be so far ahead looking at precision agriculture with respect to urban agriculture.
District of Columbia taxpayers and the U.S. Department of Agriculture fund the Firebird Agricultural Experiment Station of Causes. So our priority is to share information and training with District of Columbia residents, but awareness of the specialized urban knowledge base here at the University of the District of Columbia is expanding, and the college is welcoming more and more local and international visitors who are interested in learning more about our research and innovative techniques and technology for urban food production. Che Axum is director of the Causes Center for Urban Agriculture and Gardening Education. I spoke with Che about the connection between the activities of the UDC Firebird Farm and urban food production.
What are the different production methods that you use out here at the farm?
Well, you know, Dean, that's a good question, because in growing food for the proposed probably 9 billion people that we're going to have on the planet in 2050, we have to have different methods of growing food. So out here in the farm, we have traditional kind of growing in soil, mm-hmm. and we have also hydroponics growing, where some places might not have the soil to grow. Mm-hmm. And also we have aquaponics, which can grow fish and also food plants and things like that. So you're going to need a wide variety of different kind of growing systems to really address food and nutritional security issues, you know, in the coming years.
So the methods you're describing really are referred to as biointensive, right? Growing a lot of stuff in very small spaces. What's that all about?
Well, especially the in-soil growing method, mm-hmm. because what we really want to try to do is, when we're growing for food security, we're also growing for nutritional security also. Yeah. So growing a wide variety of crops intensively in small spaces and producing high yields and abundant crops and creating a closed system, a sustainable closed system while you're growing these crops. And the biointensive production method answers all of those questions.
So what is it all about? Describe and give us an example of what biointensive means.
Well, biointensive means biologically intensively planting crop space, putting crop spacing, putting plants closer together in spacing, uh-huh. so you can produce more in an area. But also in agreement with that, in accordance to that, you're doing growing specific crops for compost. And you're growing carbon crops for composting to make soil, mm-hmm. and you're also growing specific calorie crops too. So you're mm-hmm. trying to close the loop for nutritional security and things mm-hmm. like that.
So that's what you mean by sustainable growing methods that close the
loop. Closing the loop, yes.
It's not just the food, but it's also what is the stuff that goes back
exactly.
in the soil to
exactly.
make, to keep it fertile.
Exactly, and mm-hmm. you're growing, like I said, specific crops to make compost mm-hmm. in order to make more soil, because it takes a long time in nature for soil to be created, mm-hmm. you know, hundreds and hundreds of years, but you can do that through composting and making compost. Mm-hmm. And that adds to the fertility of your soil and adds to the soil that you have to grow plants.
So it's like a co-production.
It is, uh-huh. exactly. So co-production uh-huh. and everything is tied in together. Mm-hmm.
So one of the reasons why we think it's such an important thing to grow food, not only where we're used to in rural areas, but actually in cities where most of us live, has to do with climate change. It's real, and we're all going to have to kind of adapt to it. So what's the connection between food production and climate change?
Well, as you know, agriculture is one of the biggest offenders of the climate almost. So in order for us to really grow more food for more people, we have to grow in a way we can also sustain the planet at the same time while we're growing for folks. So that's critically important. So there's some advantages and disadvantages to the rise in temperatures with growing crops, because crops, you know, sometimes grow better, you know, under warmer temperatures, but also so do things that you don't want to grow at the farm, like weeds. So we have prolific weeds out here which grow, and you know, almost they're growing 24/7. While we're asleep, they're growing. And so we have more weed management and things like that. So there are some disadvantages and advantages to climate change, but you know, so we have to look at those things too. But definitely the production of food, we have to do it in a way which we can sustain the planet. That's critically important.
So sustainable methods, but also looking at the locations where we grow it, because if we grow it where very few people live.
Well, that's true too. So we have to do sustainable methods, you know, in the cities. Mm-hmm. So, for example, growing crops which have heat-set genes, which do well under very high temperatures, because, as you know, around 90 degrees, a certain number of days, you know, plants tend to drop blossoms sometimes. So we mm-hmm. have certain crops we're looking at which keep their blossoms under high temperatures, and we had a lot of 90-degree days this year.
We sure did.
So we had to find ways to grow crops and things like that under those high temperatures, and especially in urban areas where it's much warmer than it is probably like at here at the farm,
yeah,
as opposed to the city.
And we experienced some of that with our green roof, right? That's mm-hmm. right in the middle of the city.
Yeah.
But then there's, you know, an upside. It may be challenging to find the right kind of crops that actually tolerate these very high temperatures. But the benefit is that it kind of cools these heat islands in the city.
Well, it does. It does. So, you know, I've been collecting that data as far as those different crops. So we have a long list of crops which are heat tolerant, which we can really study up on the roof and do research. And it'd be interesting to see, because with that research and then growing the crops in containers and looking at the yields plus mm-hmm. the heat tolerance of those crops, I think it would be extremely beneficial to urban residents, mm-hmm. extremely beneficial.
So you basically run our farm out here, which is kind of an unusual farm. It's not a farm that grows things as cash crops, but we do a lot of research here too. Mm-hmm. And in addition to running the farm, we have what we call our urban food hub. So we have sort of like mini farms, like satellites
yeah.
of the farms,
yeah.
right in Washington, D.C. So that sounds like a pretty diverse role that you play here. So so tell us a little bit about your background. What did you study to prepare you for this job?
Well, I originally did not start off in farm. Many people would be surprised I did not grow up on a farm. And actually, I did not grow a food crop until I was in my early 30s.
Wow.
But when it's something's for you, it's for you.
Yeah.
And so I started farming, really. Then I went back to school to get a degree in agronomy, which is crop and soil science. And also I farmed, and I was working for the Department of Agriculture for about 20 years and doing research and things like that. So I kind of was doing quite a bit, and I kind of considered myself, I was kind of like a sponge. Mm-hmm. I mean, whatever it was about agriculture, I just soaked it up, and it just stuck. And I'm glad that I didn't pick my first profession and go into that, which was pharmacy.
Oh,
but
okay.
I'm here at the pharmacy. It's the F-A-R-M-A-C-Y.
Ah, that's beautiful.
The real pharmacy, where health really starts here. Not at the other pharmacies. Yeah. Nothing wrong with them, but it starts here.
Yeah.
If you can get this right.
So if you get the nutrition right,
yeah.
if you get people to eat right and eat the kind of foods that are
right.
grown
yeah.
in the right way, then you can kind of omit the other, right?
And
we
when
don't
you can.
Need as
and
much.
Yeah. Growing in the right way, that's the critical thing. Growing uh-huh. food the right way. I mean, growing food the natural way, which is organically and slow and just letting them mature and getting the nutrients in the soil, getting the soil really healthy so the plant is healthy and then the people will be healthy, and that's the role, that's the way to go with that.
Mm-hmm.
But it takes a lot of work and dedication to do it like that. It's not like you just throw a seed in the ground and you walk away and you come back 30, 40, 50 days and harvest it. It's
mm-hmm.
a lot of preparation that you have to do, picking the right crop,
mm-hmm.
varietal selection. So we always look at that because there's some crops that are very nutritious depending on their variety, and there's some crops that look beautiful which are not nutritious.
Mm-hmm.
Same variety of crop.
Mm-hmm.
So looking at varietal selections and things like that, so it's critically important.
Mm-hmm.
So, you know, it takes a while to get that. You can get that, but we teach all of that here.
Urban agriculture is increasingly becoming a way of life for District of Columbia residents and for urban centers around the world. The goal of the CAUSES Firebird Research Farm is to conduct research and test techniques in urban agriculture that are consistent with sustainable and organic practices. At the Firebird Research Farm, the focus of the CAUSES Center for Urban Agriculture and Gardening Education is on adapting successful, highly efficient farming techniques to small urban spaces and responding to the changing demographics through programs like the Specialty and Ethnic Crops Program. Thank you for joining me on CAUSES, a television series from the College of Agriculture, Urban Sustainability and Environmental Sciences of the University of the District of Columbia. As your public land grant university, we are committed to conducting research and offering education programs that improve the quality of life and economic opportunity for people and communities in the District of Columbia. If you would like more information, please visit us at www.udc.edu/causes. I am Sabine O'Hara. Thank you for watching. See you next time on CAUSES.